And so I asked them, what do you guys want to do tonight? How come you only wanted to know what the guys wanted to do? Why didn't you care about me? It doesn't harm anyone when you switch to inclusive terms. Instead, it proactively signals your commitment to women. Freshman becomes first-year student. Chairman becomes chair. You guys becomes you all.
Stanford recently published a harmful language list filled with common words and phrases that you shouldn't use anymore. Did you ever call out in excitement, "That's insane"? Well, don't do that, because according to Stanford, it trivializes mental health conditions. Did you ever kill two birds with one stone? That's also a no-no. Rather, you should call it doing two things at once, lest you promote animal cruelty. Don't say walk-in office hours. It trivializes disabled people. You get the idea. Stanford's list was only public for a short while before they decided to limit access to students and staff only because of the ridicule it garnered, not just from right-leaning media, but also from the left.
You should ignore this list. You should dispense of this list. And the individuals who have compiled this list need to step outside of the faculty lounge and take a good hard look at the real world around them.
When even progressives find Stanford's attempts at improving the world insincere and holier than thou, this should be an indication that what they are proposing is a little crazy. Sorry, I meant to say silly. The word crazy is now apparently also bigoted. This list is the reductio ad absurdum of political correctness. It is impossible to satirize it because it's already so dumb that it's indistinguishable from parody. It might as well be something out of South Park.
I would like to open this door for you. However, I understand the gender-based biases that this could imply.
The truth is, America is only the land of opportunity for a select few. The US has a problem with wealth inequality similar to India's, and it's only getting bigger. For those who went to an Ivy League university and have millions of dollars and private jets, the easiest way to sleep at night is to be as woke as possible. It's a distraction from the real problem of wealth inequality, and at the same time functions as an expiation of their sins. This list does nothing for the betterment of the groups that are supposedly harmed by our current word choice. We are regularly admonished to use more so-called inclusive language, but I ask, what is inclusive about it? It is alienating the average person who is made to feel like a bigoted yokel for not thinking and saying exactly what the elites prescribe. It can be argued that it's rather exclusive language, used primarily to signal the belonging to a certain social class. In fact, this is one of the known mechanisms whereby language evolves. The linguist John Gumbertz observed differences in the way high-status and low-status people speak, and that over time, phrases used by the upper class trickle down and are used by everyone. This in turn causes a change in the speech pattern of the upper class as they strive to differentiate themselves once more from the rest of society. I'm not denying that some words are genuinely hurtful or conjure up bad associations and that any decent person should avoid. But what Stanford's list is mainly doing is artificially evoking discriminatory associations to words that nobody normally had before they started digging at the history of its origin. Only this can be done with virtually half of the English language. Should we ban bad as one of the bad words? After all, bad was originally just a name for an effeminate man. It's not just that this list impartially explains how to reduce harm through speech. What it understands as harm is highly politicized, and greatly differs from many Americans' conception of harm. It recommends saying debase instead of prostitute, because that would be comparing corrupt or unworthy purposes with sex work. Of course, many people don't view prostitution as equally valuable to other forms of employment and don't want this being promoted to their children. The point is that inclusive language is not only not a solution for the problem of inequality, it positively serves to obscure it and contributes to the divisiveness in society.